Do you think that people in Britain are concerned enough about what's happening in Southern Africa?
And I think if British people really understood what is going on there, and if they're sufficiently horrified, they would allow themselves some time to say, how did it all start? And we in South Africa say it started with Britain. They had the opportunity to stop this thing happening. They missed that opportunity, they lost it. And they have landed the international community, not just the people of South Africa, not only the people of Southern Africa, but the whole international community with a very serious problem. Now, what is necessary is, of course, not to complain about what happened 75 years ago this year, but to do something about it now. And British people can do something about it now.
But how can we do something? I mean, is our stake in South Africa still large enough for us to be an effective country?
It's very large. Your stake in South Africa is very large. And if you made use of that, the results would be dramatic.
Tell me what you mean.
Well, from our position in South Africa, we see that the South African government, or the apartheid system, has drawn strength from its economic links with the outside world. It has thrived on investment that comes in from outside. If that were withdrawn, the regime would find it very difficult to operate.
And Britain is a big investor, are you saying?
Britain is a very big investor. And therefore we have said to Britain, as we have to the United States and other countries, that they should withdraw these investments, that they should sever economic links with South Africa, that they should participate in the imposition of sanctions on South Africa. Now, Britain's role would be very effective. But this is precisely what is missing.
Where's your own personal resolve, steely resolve, come from there? What's your background? Where were you brought up?
Well, I don't know whether my resolve has anything to do with my background, but I grew up on the countryside. I was born in the countryside. And for some time, that was my total world.
You say in the countryside, in what sort of surroundings?
A rural area, a peasant life. We lived on what we grew on the ground, while there was land to till. Of course, it was shrinking all the time because the population was growing and the land was not expanding.
So you herded cattle perhaps as a small
boy? Yes, I herded cattle. And then I went to school, to a mission school, and then on to another mission school. And my world began to expand.
When did you first come political, though?
I came to Johannesburg at the age of, well, about 16 or something like that, I should say. And that was a totally new world for me. And there I began to run into the harshness of life for the African. I had been cut off from this as a peasant boy. But I actually came into politics around the early 40s,
I meant it more generally, actually. When did you first begin to feel this resentment against apartheid? I mean, when did you feel the harshness of the system personally?
Well, we felt resentment even before the apartheid system came. We could feel the effects of segregation against us. But it was sharpened of course, when once we got into politics and we were getting involved, we're seeing more and more of this and understanding more clearly the role of the black men in the South African situation.
But you've talked a lot about the violence of the system. I mean, did you suffer personally?
I was assaulted several times by the police. I've been arrested, of course. I've been locked up. I was even locked up the day before I was due to get married.
Why?
Just picked up because I had no passes, no documents to prove that I was entitled to be where I was. But this was much later, much later. Black people, and I mean black people, colored people, people of Indian origin, Africans, few can escape the feeling that they are not humans in terms of those who govern them. The laws that are applied to them are laws that are meant for subhumans. You can't escape this. And this was the case even before the coming of the apartheid regime in 1948 was a very sharp difference. But even before that, there was segregation.
But there was a period, wasn't there, sort of in the 50s, that you wanted to be a priest. How difficult was it for you personally to make that change from non-violent protest, which was espoused, for instance, by Chief Lutuli very much, who was the president of ANC before you, and dedicate yourself to overthrowing, by whatever means, the apartheid system?
Well, it was very difficult. You know, if you are being attacked, if you are being beaten up every day, if you are being shot at, if you are being insulted and subjected to inhumanities and indignities, and you are a man, you are a human being, and this is being done to you by another human being, you can put up with this for some time, but you do reach a point where you feel you must resist and you must fight back. Now, it was very difficult for us not to fight back when once you had this violent onslaught on a whole people. It was very difficult not to fight back, but we decided not to. We decided that we would remain non-violent, and as the years went by, it became increasingly difficult to be non-violent. But the violence was growing, which was increasing in relation to our determined resistance. So you had an escalation there of determination, determined non-violent struggle with increasing armed force, with shootings and beatings up and armed police and so on, until this whole thing developed to a kind of climax when there was the Sharpeville massacre. Beyond that, it was still more difficult not to be violent, but we still went on.
Sharpeville, just let me recap, was when people were demonstrating in 1960 against the pass laws.
They were demonstrating against the pass laws, and they were shot at and massacred.
And so you're saying for you that there was no moral dilemma ever, even though you were a follower of Chief Lutuli, who said no violence, no dilemma for you in taking the ANC into a more active phase of its development?
No, it wasn't a moral dilemma. If you are in struggle, if you are part of a people, part of a struggle, and you take a decision, a cruel decision, a hard decision, then you go by that decision because there's nothing else to do. The point to make is that when you have no alternative, when you are being crushed and you there's no way of saving yourself, of stopping the attack, then you decide to be violent, and you can be very violent in order to get out of this problem, in order to get rid of the assailant, to get rid of the criminal.
After Sharpeville, of course, you went into exile in southern Africa, in Zambia, and in a certain extent in Tanzania. How difficult a period was that, both for you and the ANC?
Well, it was difficult because, for one thing, one had not lived in exile before, and you were working away from your people, from normal surroundings, even from members of the organization. You were most of the time alone.
And of course,
and
your wife was
moving from country to country. Well, my wife was remained at home for some time. Subsequently, she also came out. And it was very difficult, but you are sustained by your conviction that what you are doing will yield results, that it cannot fail, however difficult it is. And I often left my wife lying in bed, ill, with the children, and came and spent a day and went off to the next place. And I was flying up and down to try and build support, international support for our struggle. And at the beginning, it was difficult. But as we went along, the apartheid issue was getting picked up by people and making it their own issue. The African states were becoming independent, and they were all taking up the question of apartheid as their issue. This helped a great deal. In due course, we felt we had a growing international support, and that made things easier. But not easier in terms of progress in the struggle in South Africa. The apartheid system was very much there. We needed to build up a great deal more support. We needed ourselves to struggle with greater determination and make greater sacrifices in order to move towards bringing the system down.
Everyone says to me that 1976 was a crucial turning point. How was that?
In the sense that although we had had young people always involved in the struggle, I mean, we ourselves, I was young, Nelson Mandela and others were young when we entered politics seriously. But in 1976, you had the Soweto massacre. Now,
what is that?
The police shot at and killed, on our estimates, over 1,000 people, mainly young people, students, including children, over 1,000. And simply shooting at them, and they and of course the young people were resisting, mm-hmm. but they were resisting again with stones, and they were meeting this volleys of gunfire, and as many as over 1,000 were killed in all this altogether.
And so what you're saying is that that violent, enormously violent act politicized the youth?
Yes, that
the youth.
Drew the youth into struggle. And they have stayed there because apartheid has remained the same. It has remained as cruel as it was in June 1976. The killings have continued. The pressure of the system on the people has remained there. And that was the significance, therefore, of 1976, that it threw into struggle large numbers, active struggle, into activity.
It's made ANC a much more militant organization. I mean, is that and really polarized the situation between ANC and the right wing backlash that we're now seeing in South Africa? Has that created difficulties for you? In that you've been forced to adopt a much more extreme position than perhaps you'd have liked, partly because of those young and angry young men that came out of South Africa at the time.
Yes, well, the militancy of the ANC actually started in the 70s and has never gone down. In the 50s, I can't imagine an organization more militant than the ANC was then. But what has happened, of course, this militancy has really been maintained. We've always been determined that we are going to fight until we win our struggle. There's never been any relaxation on that score. And members of the ANC can all be said to be militant in terms of their resolve to make sacrifices, to ensure that the apartheid system is ended.
But we seem now to be at a new phase, if you like, in the struggle. And you yourself have said it's an exciting phase of the drama. Do you think this is really different? Are you really changing pace, or are things really changing in South Africa now?
Well, I think we're making a great deal of progress.
Is the end in sight?
I think the end is in sight. But between now and the end that is in sight, there is going to be a lot of trouble in South Africa. The conflict is simply bound to escalate, because not enough as yet is being done internationally.
Are you saying there's going to be a bloodbath?
I don't want to call it a bloodbath. It could become a bloodbath. I mean, we must be prepared for that. If conflict escalates and keeps on escalating, no one can say how far it will go. But it's possible to say that we can limit the extent to which the escalation goes if there are other forces coming into play apart from our own struggle inside South Africa.
Yes.
Our own struggle cannot avoid conflict, but, armed conflict.
But you're saying quite directly, quite specifically, that sanctions could stop a bloodbath.
I'm saying that sanctions could stop a bloodbath. I am certain about this. We've always been sure that this is it. But if sanctions do not come and are not effective, then the only option we have is to fight with everything we have. And it then depends on how much pressure we can put on the regime. And the pressure we can put on the regime must be expressed in terms of struggle, of armed struggle, of armed conflict, of escalating conflict.
Doesn't the prospect of uncontrollable violence worry you? Spontaneous violence? Because you've got a lot to lose, or whatever comes after.
No. If the system is as violent as it is, it must be expected that it will breed violence, and one cannot always control the nature of that violence.
Yes, but as a potential leader, you have to look not only to the present, surely, but also to the future. What society are you going to set up in South Africa?
My first concern is to do everything possible to remove the apartheid system. We can't have the apartheid system. You know, just about anything is welcome as an alternative to the apartheid system. So that must be accepted, that the apartheid system must go. If we have to be violent for that purpose, we shall be. If perhaps part of that violence gets out of control, we will try and control it, but we might fail. But at the end of the day, we must be able to say, we've destroyed the apartheid system. Let me put it this way. When the armies of Europe marched against Hitler, many things went wrong there. Many things wrong. Wrong people were bombed and killed. Whole populations were leveled down. Whole cities were destroyed. Of old people, children, innocent people were simply sitting there. They were all leveled and they were all killed. In a way, this was uncontrolled violence, because the idea was not to go and kill or destroy cities and kill hundreds and thousands of children. But the idea was to defeat Hitler. That was the objective. And nothing was going to stop the war until that had been achieved. The Americans exploded the Hiroshima bomb. That was a terrible thing.
So what you're
but
saying?
They were all, and we condemned them for it. But so it was part of the war which sought to destroy Nazism.
So no compromise, one man, one vote must be established. But tell me, is there any room for negotiation on the time scale over which that must happen? Or are you asking for complete capitulation?
No, we are not asking for complete capitulation. We don't think it's necessary. In 1979, Ian Smith came here and met leaders of the Liberation Movement of Zimbabwe. There was a war going on there. And they talked and talked and talked, and in the end they reached a conclusion, they reach agreement, and that kind of thing can happen in our case.
So there is hope of negotiation.
There is hope for negotiation. The only thing is that for the moment, and we are talking a great deal about negotiation these days, but for the moment we can see, and think everybody can see, that border does not really want negotiation. He does not want to talk to the ANC. He does not even want other people to talk to the ANC. He doesn't want the business community to talk to the ANC, or the religious community, or even young people to talk with their counterparts in the ANC. He is insistent on repression.
So the end isn't in sight?
So the end isn't in sight. We have said, release Nelson Mandela. Let Nelson Mandela and other political prisoners and leaders come out of jail and be part of a process which could quite conceivably lead to negotiation. He has refused to do that. Lift the state of emergency. He's not lifting it, he's extending it. So as of now, all we can say is that perhaps at some point he will be convinced that it is in his own interests to talk about a new system in South Africa.
We're almost out of time. I'd like to end, if I may, personally. Are you still a practicing Christian after all you've been saying?
Well, a practicing Christian, I suppose, is a person who goes to church every Sunday. I don't. I find myself there now and again. But I have a very strong Christian background. My parents were devoted Christians. I went to mission schools. I went to the university and stayed in a hostel run by the Anglican Church. I came back to teach in a mission school. So we have had all this. The priority now, I even offered myself for the ministry. I was put out by the intensity of the struggle and the demands of the struggle. And that is the priority at the moment, is to get freedom for my people.
Do you fear for your own life?
No. No, not at all.
The offices in which we're sitting have been bombed? Not at all? Does your wife worry about you?
Well, I'm sure she does. She does. Every wife would. She does, the children do, everybody else do. My colleagues worry about me in the ANC. I myself expect that I will be killed by the regime or its agents. And perhaps there's nothing one can do about that. One doesn't worry about these things. If you have a struggle to fight, it has all got its dangers and hazards. And it even involves getting assassinated. But that's no deterrent. You've got to go for the objective that we've set ourselves, and that is what I'm doing.